right now, voices spouting hate and racism are mixing with voices spouting justice and equality. And so far, thankfully, it is just words that are clashing. I'm talking about Washington, D.C., where protests mark 1 year since a rally of white supremacists in Charlottesville, Virginia, turned violent, and one woman was mowed down by a car and killed. A relatively small group of people from far-right groups, including the KKK and the neo-Nazis, marched through the nation's capital a short time ago, greatly outnumbered by people trying to shut them down. Counter-protesters facing down those white supremacists and letting them know they are not welcome. CNN's Brian Todd and Sarah Seidner are in Washington for us. Brian, from what you have seen, how do the crowd sizes compare, the white supremacists and the counter protesters, and what kind of police presence has been out there?
Anna, it's been a very large police presence, as you can see behind me. Some of these protesters are now kind of angrily chanting and yelling at police because we just saw this line of police officers kind of bolster their ranks here, and we saw some police motorcycles kind of rev their engines, so that kind of drew this crowd closer to the police, and now they're kind of just chanting and yelling things at police. No major flare-ups here yet, but again, these are some of the Antifa protesters. Some Black Lives Matter protesters are here. The Antifa protesters, the anti-fascist protesters, often show up wearing some of the garb that you see over here, you know, black helmets, black gas masks, sometimes bandanas over their faces. And they sometimes kind of get into some of these confrontations with police. But so far here, Anna, not really much of a confrontation. It's just a lot of yelling. This is not atypical for a situation like this. We're hearing some chants here, and again, they're yelling at police. Police are just kind of holding their ground. Pretty commonplace for a situation like this. The white supremacist protesters were probably about 200 to 300 yards that way, and again, the police are not letting these people get anywhere near them. That's been a key factor here, keeping the distance between these anti-racist protesters and the white supremacists. They really have not been able to get close enough to maybe even be heard by them, even though the crowds here are much more numerous than the white supremacists. Sana.
And obviously the weather now perhaps impacting these protests and where they go from here. Sarah Seidner also joining us. Looks like it's cleared out a little bit where you are, Sarah.
Cleared out is a good word, good way to put it. The Unite the Right organizers and all of the few people that were here, they are marching, have just been put into a vehicle. They have left. And so the scene basically is one of quiet on this side, if you will. That is where they had their speakers. They were very, very quiet in comparison. And I want to swing around real quick now because that is the Unite the Right organizers and marchers leaving with the police escort there. They're moving them out both ways, trying to get them out. But look, we're talking about maybe 10, 15, at the most 20 people that came for this. You could definitely count the numbers here. And you can see how big the police presence is with just the number of officers that are getting them out and trying to move them out of the area. There are dozens of officers that are down. You can see at the very end in those very bright green vests. And then you have the horses that are also here. They have managed to keep these two apart. And the other side, by the way, at this point, may not know that the Unite the Right protesters are now
interrupt you because
out of
there's
the
some,
area.
Some stuff going on where Brian Todd is, I'm told. Brian, fill us in.
Anna, some of the police officers have just come up to the line here, and I think a couple of them went through the line, and that has kind of drawn the crowd over here, again, just yelling all sorts of epithets and other things at the police. There seems to be some excitement over here where the police have approached, and now some people have started throwing some things, but some of these other people are telling them not to throw some things. So, again, it's a bit of a tense situation here. Not atypical of these situations where, you know, something flares up, maybe not much of an incident, and it gets a little bit blown out of proportion. Again, the police have come up to this area here and may be pushing through. I can't quite see, but they are talking to some people, and I'm trying to see if there's a confrontation here, Anna. Yeah, some people here encouraging others not to throw things at the police. And what's unclear is whether the police want to kind of come through here and clear a path for anyone, even though the white supremacists are not scheduled to speak for about 30 minutes. And now it's just basically a stare down and some chanting where protesters are right face to face with the police, Anna.
Okay, Brian Todd, we will continue to monitor this situation and we'll check back with you as it continues to unfold. We should note, as Sarah Seidner just mentioned, it appears the white supremacists already did the speaking that was scheduled to happen a little bit later and have since left this area. So now it appears to be this large group of what have been considered counter protesters who came out to denounce hate and to really protest against bigotry and racism. Again, this is the live shot from where those white supremacists had initially been rallying. Now, this, again, happening in the nation's capital today. Let me get to Charlottesville, Virginia now, where those violent rallies happened 1 year ago. CNN's Kaylee Hartung is joining us from there. And Kaylee, I know you had a chance to speak to the mother of Heather Heyer, that young woman who lost her life while protesting against neo-Nazis last year.
I did, Anna. And Heather Heyer's mother, Susan Bro, says it's not unusual for her to visit the site of her daughter's death, this intersection just behind me, protected by police cars. But she says typically when she does, she's the only one there. Of course, that wasn't the case today. It was a very solemn moment. Many supporters came out to surround her, to hope to give her a moment to herself, to remember her daughter, but also there, other survivors of that attack. Heather Heyer's mother said this wasn't just about Heather. There were so many other people impacted by that moment, a point well taken by those in attendance. But shortly after this very solemn moment, some tensions erupted in the street just behind me. You can see those police cars now barricading that street, but at that time, there were also physical barricades, a line of policemen wanting to protect those mourning. But some people didn't see it that way. Some people in this town, in that counter-protester faction that we've come to know, they've been very unhappy with this large-scale police presence, so there was a confrontation. Heather Heyer's mother was able to observe what happened in that moment, and I asked her about it.
The group who was confronting police used Heather's name. They chanted her name.
Yeah, I didn't... I wasn't real appreciative of that, but it is what it is.
What is your message to people who do that?
I don't know that I have one. Heather's sort of public property in a way. They weren't defaming her. They weren't using her name to support violence. But I'm glad it calmed down.
Al, those tensions calmed down because there was compromise, communication, and negotiation between those counter-protesters of sorts and the police. The clergy intervened and a conversation was had to allow the police to back up from that space. So much of the focus beyond those tensions, though, Anna, has been on the healing process, which, again, Heather Heyer's mother says is a matter for more than just her.
There were some people there very traumatized because they had been there last year and it was very challenging for them. One young man hugged me and he just couldn't stop the tears rolling down his cheeks. Another one came up and said he had been there last year and he's having a really hard time talking to me, and I've learned to spot. I said, "Have you been in counseling yet?" "Well, I have some friends I can talk to." And I said, "You need counseling and there's money available if you need it. There are funds available with the victims fund. If you need it, you need to go into counseling." He said, "I'll think about it." I hope he does, because the longer you delay, the worse it gets, was what I've been told. Lot of hurting and needy people still. There are many people. I saw one young lady that just finished her third or fourth and final surgery about a month ago, and she walked up to hug me, and that was awesome.
The young woman Susan was just talking about that, named Sophie, a survivor of the attack a year ago. She's been one of the students from UVA who's been leading this counter-protest movement this weekend, voicing their frustration and the anger that they still have towards law enforcement. But a sign of the progress that was made today, I told you about that moment of compromise, Anna. Well, we had known the plan all weekend was for this downtown mall area to be a secured perimeter. Pedestrians were only supposed to be allowed in two entrances and no vehicular traffic would be allowed across those streets. Among the lessons learned from what happened here a year ago, well, after that conversation was had, police agreed to remove that secure perimeter. Any pedestrian can now walk up this street in particular, visit Heather Heyer's Memorial. But if you see that large vehicle blocking that road, the purpose of that, again, to protect the people of Charlottesville, to protect these streets, to not allow any vehicles to cross through that heavily pedestrian area.